Hello everyone, I'm Balthazar Boer and I'm happy to present you Transferable eCash, a cleaner model and the first practical instantiation, a joint work with Georg Fuchsbauer and Chen Qian. Because many of you are not familiar with Transferable eCash and probably even with eCash, I will introduce you the main definitions in a first part, and I will attempt to explain you what are the difficulties to define anonymity notions in such a context. Then, I will briefly summarize our contributions with some comparisons to the state of art. And finally, I will sketch a simplified version of our scheme. eCash is a basic payment system with three types of entities. A bank, which is authorized to issue coin to a user, here Alice, who is allowed to spend this coin at the shop. We can thus deposit this coin at the bank. If it is very easy to make such a system with basic cryptographic functionalities such as signatures, the goal here is to protect the privacy of the users and the merchants against a curious bank. This model has been developed by Chaum in the 80s, and I will be a little bit more precise about what does transactions anonymity mean in his work. With his definitions, Chaum guarantees us that the bank can't identify the coin issued as the coin received. It means that the bank cannot link Alice and the merchant. As it is written here, Chaum has not only defined the main notions, but has also built a first instantiation in the 80s, and then has deployed a concrete system with his company DigiCash in the 90s. The main drawback of such a system, in an offline context, is the non-transferability. Indeed, the merchant cannot directly spend the coin received to another merchant. That's why, more recently, researchers have developed a more powerful scheme which merges the user-merchant statuses by authorizing an arbitrary amount of transfers without any communication with the bank. And of course, we would like to still have anonymity guarantees. I will not detail all the numerous publications about transferable eCash. But the important thing to know is that in 2015, Baldimitti, Chase, Fuchsbauer and Kohlweiss proposed the first polynomial time scheme which verifies satisfying anonymity properties. As I will explain later, our work is based on their paper. Now, I would like to address to people not aware of the challenges in offline transactions. I will focus on the basic aspects of eCash first. So, what is the double spending? It's remarkable that we can't avoid unhonest users to double spend. For example, here, if Alice receives the coin with this identifier, because it's classical data, she can transfer the coin to Bob and then transfer it to Charlie. And because there is no communication between Charlie, Bob and the bank, both transactions will be validated. And at this step, Alice has created unauthorized money, because she only receives one coin and transfers two. She double spends. So, if we cannot avoid this situation in theory, we have to avoid it in practice to make the system economically sustainable. We need to have a minimal functionality which detects such a fraudster. Then, it implies that we have to force Alice to put data related to her identity in the transferred coin. And As the first implications, it raises efficiency issue, because it implies that the size of the coin will increase after each transfer. For example, here, if Charlie transfers his coin to Bobette, the coin received by her will have information about the identity of Alice and about the identity of Charlie, because Charlie is also a potential double spender. And it raises also anonymity issue, but I will speak about that later. So, the important thing to know is the fact that to prevent double spending, we need to have a minimal functionality which detects such a fraudster. This functionality would take as input two deposited coins, would detect whether the coins have the same origin, and would then output the identity of the fraudster if there is one, and else would output OK. So now we can define anonymity notions. First, the coin anonymity, the most natural definition, which can be seen as a generalization of the charm's anonymity. Similarly, it guarantees us that the bank cannot link a deposited coin and a withdrawn coin. The only difference is the fact that now the chain's size is arbitrary big. But now, because a user can receive a coin he has previously owned, we have to define an analog feature which protects us against such a curious user. For example, here, we do not want to authorize Alice to link the coin transferred to Bob and the coin received from the shop. We call this property coin transparency. But what if the bank and Alice collude? Then we will see how whole security might break down. We would like to have the same guarantee as before, even in this case. We would like to be sure that this team can't link the coin given to Bob and the coin deposited by the shop. But you can notice that if Alice deposits the coin she transferred to Bob, the bank, by using the minimal functionality I've spoken before, could link the coin spent by Alice to Bob and the coin deposited by the store, because if the detector told us both coins have the same origin, then by definition, the coalition could deduce a link between these coins. So this simple example shows us that we have to limit the anonymity properties if we consider coalition attacks. For this reason, we can only guarantee that this coalition would not be able to know the identity of an intermediate owner of the coin in the transaction chain. For example, here the coalition can't be sure if this specific owner is Charlie Brown or Charlie Chaplin. So the identities of intermediate owners are protected. So now I would like to speak about our contribution by comparing it to the work of 2015. First, we have rewritten the anonymity definition by making it simpler to our opinion, and we have also given more descriptive names to these definitions. Secondly, we have formalized some missing security properties. Here I would like to give you a quick example. It's not related to anonymity notions, it's more about economical notions. Let's suppose that Alice receives a coin of someone, very suspect. But let's suppose that the spender respects the protocol from Alice's point of view. But in reality, The spender, who was malicious, has completely broken the coin. And for this reason, Alice can't transfer the coin to a potential honest receiver, such as Bob. In previous paper, this attack was not considered at all. And in our work, we have formalized a property which guarantees that to Alice that her coin will be accepted by an honest user. And it's really important to make the economical system sustainable, because the users need to have the guarantee that the money is valid, even the spender is not honest. And finally, we have built a new scheme, more efficient than the previous one of 2015. And now I will present you a sketch of our scheme. Suppose Alice wants to withdraw a coin. Then she would generate a serial number, SN0, and ask the bank for a signature on it. And if Bob wants to receive this coin, he should also generate a serial number, SN1, and Alice, to confirm the transfer, will create a tag related to both serial numbers and which encodes her identity. And Bob will do the same with Charlie for the next transaction. You can notice that the size of coin grows after each transaction, but as I've explained before, it's necessary to prevent double spending. Now let's consider that Alice wants double spend her coin to Bobette. Then Bobette would generate a new serial number, SN1 prime, and Alice has to create another tag, T1 prime, that links her already used serial number SN0 with the new one of Bobette, SN1 prime. So in the end of the chain, the bank will detect easily the fraud by noticing twice the same initial serial number. And because of tag exculpability, a property already used in the previous scheme, the bank will retrieve the identity of the fraudster, here Alice. So now a good question is how to make such a system anonymous. First, look at the user anonymity. To briefly recall the user notion, it guarantees us that even a coalition can't guess the identity of an intermediate owner. So let's suppose that Alice is with the bank. In the end of the transaction, the bank will receive all serial numbers and tags, and in particular the serial number and the tag which has been generated by Charlie. Then it's important that tags and serial numbers are not linkable to the user who generates them. For example, here it should be difficult for the bank to guess if the generator was Charlie Brown or Charlie Chaplin. Fortunately, this property was already achieved in the previous work of Baldimizi et al. Now, we would like to know if our scheme verifies the coin anonymity, which guarantees us that the bank can't recognize an issued coin. We have to focus on the withdrawal of a coin. At this step, the bank just signs on Alice's serial number, but in the end of the transaction chain, the bank will obtain the same signature and the same serial number. So it's important to avoid the bank to have access to this data during the withdrawal. Similarly to the original Chaum's scheme, we have to use blind signatures. It means that the signer signs a message without learning it, and moreover, cannot recognize the resulting signature to the signing session. And in order to tie it to the rest of our construction, we use a special type of blind signature constructed from so-called commuting signatures. So we modify a bit our protocol to satisfy coin anonymity, but now we would like also to achieve a more specific property to the transferable context, the coin transparency. So, Alice, to generate the tag, has seen the serial number of Bob. Moreover, she has herself generated her serial number and her tag. She could recognize this data if the coin is transferred back to her. To overcome this issue, we have made the choice to commit all the sensitive data and prove their validity by using Grossi proofs. Then Alice should commit her serial number, and Bob should commit his tag. Alice's tag and her own serial number. His own serial number. But it's not enough because Alice could recognize the commitment she herself generated. Fortunately, commitments and zero-knowledge proofs can be re-randomized, and thus Alice cannot anymore recognize the data she generated. But by adding this, we prevent the bank from having access to the serial numbers and tags. Then, she cannot anymore detect double spending, and it's a big issue. Thus, we have to clone these elements outside the commitments, but then it becomes problematic again for Bob's privacy. That's why we have decided to encrypt the clone data and give the secret key to the bank, and to randomize the ciphertext to prevent Alice from recognizing the serial number she has encrypted herself. To make this possible, we have built a new randomizable encryption scheme which fits perfectly to our use case. This scheme was inspired by a one developed by Libert Peters and Kian in 2017. I will not give you any more details about our scheme, but as you can imagine, a big difficulty is to make work all these powerful primitives in a unified protocol. But before finishing, I would like to talk about efficiency. Even it's more efficient than a previous scheme, the cost is not negligible. We can look in more detail the analysis of our scheme and notice that everything is short except the coin itself. And the important factor is that one. It told us that after each transfer, the size increases of 104 group elements, thus approximately 20 kilobits. It might seem big, but it is really the first even remotely practical construction of transferable cache which achieves satisfying anonymity notions. I will not give any more details about our work, but if you have questions on it, don't hesitate to contact us by email. And before telling you goodbye, I would like to thank you for your attention.